but it's tripped up and stopped at the 7-yard line.
Now running up the middle, Belisari. To the 5, to the house, he's got it.
Welcome to Buckeyes 99, a look back at the 1999 football season for the Ohio State football program. I'm Jeff Hogan. 1999 was a perplexing and uncharacteristic year for Ohio State, a year that saw a 6-6 record, but they were not alone. Big-name programs from around the country saw unexpected down years as well. Programs like Notre Dame, USC, UCLA, and Arizona. But the Buckeyes looked poised to get right back on track in the year 2000. 1999 for these student athletes was more than just a learning experience in the classroom.
Building itself into one of the top programs in college football, Ohio State was used to having to replace quality players each year. But 1998 was no ordinary year. An 11-1 season was capped off by a win in the Sugar Bowl and a second place finish in both major polls. No less than 8 players, including 3 in the first round, were drafted into the NFL. Another 5 players went to camps as rookie free agents. 1999 was definitely a learning experience. At times, as many as 10 freshmen or sophomores found themselves in the starting lineup. This was a team that was forced to learn on the job.
We got a lot of talent coming back. You know, we got a lot more experience this year. So, I mean, we're definitely looking forward to next year.
Nowhere on the team is that more evident than at the quarterback position. Sophomore Steve Belisari took over the job in the third game of the year and showed flashes of brilliance.
Belisari the snap, fakes the handoff, turns to the 34 to throw. Fakes, now fires for Rambo, long on the right side. He's got it at the 15 and into the end zone, Kenyon Rambo.
Steve's going to be a very good football player for us. We've got to do a better job protecting him, and he's got to do a better job of picking out the open receiver, getting the ball to him. I think he's got a lot of future in him.
Joining him on offense will be tailbacks Jonathan Wells and Derek Combs, both of whom showed promise. Fullback Jamar Martin started 6 games in place of the injured Matt Keller. At wide receiver, Kenyon Rambo and Reggie Germany will return for their senior years. Rambo caught 41 passes for 833 yards and 6 touchdowns, while Germany hauled in 43 passes for 656 yards and 1 score. The offensive line returns 4 players with starting experience, including Tyson Walter, who started his first 3 years. On defense, the Buckeyes have a lot to look forward to, especially if junior linebacker Niall Diggs returns for his senior year. That would give Ohio State 15 of its top 20 tacklers back from 1999. Up front, sophomores Mike Collins and Ryan Pickett established themselves as capable run stoppers, while Rodney Bailey and Brent Johnson are back for a 3rd year on the ends. 5 others on the defensive line saw extensive action. Depending on Diggs coming back at linebacker, all 3 starters could return at that position. The junior from Los Angeles is already tied for 6th in OSU career tackles for loss and tied for 5th in career sacks. The Buckeye secondary saw 2 emerging stars this season. Sophomore cornerback Nate Clements was 2nd on the team in tackles and interceptions, while true freshman Michael Doss totaled a team-high 29 tackles in the last 3 games of the year. Special teams-wise, kicker Dan Stoltz needs 97 points next year to become the school's all-time leading scorer. Overall, 21 players with starting experience will be back for more in the fall of 2000. It is now up to them to take the experience gained from this year and improve on it over the winter.
I think we're going to be good. You know, we just going to have to work hard this offseason. We're going to have to work real hard.
We have a very good future in front of us. I mean, I'm going to be a senior next year. Hopefully, I'll be a captain. I mean, we just got to work on things. I mean, we know the things that we made mistakes this season, so we just got to work on it on the offseason.
Got a great assistant football coaching staff here. We've got great young talent in this program, so let's get it on. Let's continue winning.
For the 2nd time in 5 years, the Ohio State football program began its season with a trip to the Meadowlands for the kickoff classic. It also marked the 4th time in 6 years the Buckeyes played in a preseason game. With a young, inexperienced team, head coach John Cooper welcomed that extra game and practice time.
The season's first opponent was Miami of Florida, just the 2nd time in history that these 2 national powers have met on the gridiron. It didn't take much time for the Buckeyes to realize things weren't going to be as easy as they were in 1998. On Miami's 2nd offensive play, James Jackson slipped to the outside and outraced the OSU secondary for a 44-yard touchdown. But the Buckeyes bounced right back. On the next play from scrimmage, Michael Wiley got loose for a huge 69-yard run, setting up a Dan Stoltz field goal, and Ohio State got to within 7-3. Junior linebacker Niall Diggs then answered the call on defense.
Hurricanes with a 7-3 lead. Buckeyes showing a possible blitz. Kelly back to throw. Diggs knocks the ball loose, and it's picked up by Buckeye at the 15, and then Rodney Bailey is tackled inside the 10-yard line.
The first touchdown of the year resulted from that turnover. Austin Mockerman to Steve Wisniewski for the score, and Ohio State took a 9-7 lead. The biggest question mark entering the 1999 season was at the quarterback position. Mockerman got the nod for the start, but another sophomore, Steve Belisari, also saw playing time. Unfortunately, Belisari got off to a shaky start. He only played two series, with the second one ending on a bad center exchange. Miami capitalized on the mistake. Kenny Kelly threw deep to Mondrell Fulcher for a 42-yard pickup, setting up first and goal for the Hurricanes. Kelly got the glory when this bootleg play gave him a wide-open path to the end zone, and with a two-point conversion, it was 15-9 Miami. After an OSU punt, the Hurricanes stormed to another touchdown.
And Kelly calls for the ball. He's got it, hands off. Now he fakes the handoff, throws it long, down the right side of the field for Santana Moss, who's got it at the 25. Curls to the middle, headed left side, 15, 10, 5, and touchdown. Santana Moss from Kenny Kelly. Moss had to wait for a slow floater to come down into his hands on the right side. Curled to the middle of the field, and when it's all said and done, 67 yards for the score.
Add another two-point conversion, and Ohio State trailed at the half, 23-9. As exciting as the first half was, the second 30 minutes was less than entertaining. The half began with a trade of turnovers. Kelly coughed it up on a sack for the second time, with James Cotton providing the hit and Jason Ott the recovery. But a problem that would plague the Buckeyes all year was fumbles. Michael Wiley gave it back to Miami on the very next play. The only scoring of the half was set up by the running of Jonathan Wells. He carried 11 times for 44 yards before leaving the game with an ankle injury. Dan Stoltz hit his second three-pointer of the game to conclude the scoring at 23-12. Plenty of room for improvement could be seen in the near future for Ohio State. Only 220 yards of offense contributed to the first season-opening loss for the Buckeyes since 1986. Ohio State had 2 weeks off to prepare for the next game, and they would need it, with 14th-ranked UCLA visiting Columbus for the Buckeyes' home opener. Adding to the atmosphere was just the fourth night game in Ohio Stadium history. OSU had to begin to wonder about the new season. UCLA jumped to a 7-0 lead on one of the most bizarre plays you'll ever see. Matt Stanley, the Bruins sophomore fullback who grew up in nearby Bexley, picked the ball off his teammate's back and then raced 67 yards for the score. A look at a replay shows Ahmed Plummer would have had the interception, except he collided with teammate Cortland Bullard, jarring the ball loose, landing on the back of UCLA receiver Freddie Mitchell. That and some Westwood wizardry seemed to stun the OSU defense. Mitchell threw a pass back to quarterback Drew Bennett for an 18-yard gain, setting up a field goal for a 10-0 UCLA lead early in the second quarter. OSU responded with its first lengthy drive of the season. 10 plays covering 81 yards included Austin Mockerman's pass to Michael Wiley, a play that picked up 13 yards and gained an important first down. Wiley was rewarded when his number was called from the three. He scored the first touchdown of his senior year, and it was 10-7 Bruins. Then the offense was further sparked by a guy who struggled in the opener. Steve Belisari came in and stretched the UCLA defense. Ohio State took a 14-10 lead when Belisari found Kenyon Rambo in the end zone, a combination that would fuel the offense for the next three games. As well as possessing a strong arm, Steve Belisari showed he was swift of foot. After a punt, the crafty quarterback converted a 3rd-and-8 by scrambling and fighting his way to a first down. Michael Wiley's second touchdown run gave the Buckeyes a 21-10 lead and plenty of momentum going into halftime. The second half began with a surprise for the OSU defense. UCLA ran the option and used an end-around to move inside the Ohio State 10-yard line. Deshaun Foster made it a game once again when he ran it in for the last 7 yards, and UCLA had new life, trailing by just 4 points. The Bruins were moving again when senior Ahmed Plummer showed why he was a Thorpe Award candidate. He picked off Bennett in Ohio State territory, one of four turnovers in the third quarter, two by each team. But the quarter ended well after Belisari found Steve Wisniewski on a 22-yard pass play. Jamar Martin, filling in for the injured Matt Keller, scored from 3 yards out to give Ohio State some breathing room at 28-17. This game saw junior wide receiver Kenyon Rambo assert himself as the next great Buckeye wideout. That play gained 12 yards and was sparked by a bruising block from quarterback Steve Belisari. Those two continued to do damage, hooking up for an 8-yard score, and the Buckeyes took control 35-17. Reggie Germany also had a great game for the Buckeyes, pulling in 7 passes for 115 yards. Michael Wiley added 119 yards rushing on 23 carries to go along with his 2 touchdowns. The Buckeyes bounced back from the Miami loss to pick up a 42-20 win, and in the process, settled on a starting quarterback.
I would think that he would probably be our starting quarterback if we had a chance to look at the film. But we need them both. That's one reason I put Austin back in the ballgame. You know, one of them starts, the other one's one play away from being in there. And I thought Austin did some nice things. It's not like he didn't do anything. Steve really helped us running the football. And, you know, right now there's no question in my mind, based on the way we played tonight, though, that Steve was the best quarterback on the field.
In the season's third game, Ohio State took the field against Ohio University for the first time since 1902. In 3 previous meetings, the Bobcats did not register a single point against the Buckeyes. But that changed just a minute and a half into the second quarter. Kevin Kerr connected on a 44-yard field goal to tie the game at 3 apiece. The Bobcats didn't stop there. Jamar Martin couldn't hang on to this Steve Belisari pass in the end zone, and the pigskin wound up in the hands of an Ohio defender. After the teams traded punts, the green and white went on the move. Not even attempting a pass in the first 20 minutes, Dontrell Jackson went up top to Drew Dwyer for 19 yards, first and goal Bobcats. On the next play, Chad Brinker bullied his way into the end zone, and inexplicably, Ohio had a 10-3 lead on the Buckeyes. That seemed to wake up Ohio State. Steve Belisari moved the team downfield with a 24-yard chunk coming on this great catch by Kenyon Rambo. Not losing sight of his favorite target, the duo hooked up again for a 15-yard touchdown pass with 1:21 left in the half. It was not supposed to be this way, but Ohio State and Ohio were tied at the break. Whatever was said in the locker room at the half worked. Belisari to Rambo for 18 yards. On a counterplay, Michael Wiley turned upfield for a 37-yard pickup, just missing out on hitting pay dirt. No worries, though. Wiley was rewarded on the next play, picking up his 3rd touchdown of the year and giving Ohio State a 17-10 lead. Momentum swung fully in Ohio State's favor following these 3 straight plays. Buckeyes Award candidate Niall Diggs laid a big lick on Ohio's Joe Fondale, forcing a punt.
And now all kind of motion on the punt team, and it's a fake punt. Hand off to a running back who turns around. It's Ostadil, the punter. He's running around at his own 15, hit and drop. He faked a handoff going wide to the right, and Ostadil hang on to the football. And Tony Locke, a walk-on wide receiver from Urbana, comes up to make the play.
On the next play, Wiley darted around the left end to pick up those 15 yards and give Ohio State a 14-point lead. It was the 6th multi-touchdown game of his career. Kenyon Rambo also got in the end zone twice, the 2nd week in a row for him. He caught a crossing route and then outran the Bobcats secondary for a 68-yard score. Another great game for Rambo. The junior from Cerritos, California, had 7 catches for 181 yards. It wasn't the prettiest of wins, but the Buckeyes moved their record to 2-1 by a 40-16 count. Another Ohio school visited Columbus in the season's 4th game. 1931 was the last time the Buckeyes played 2 in-state opponents in the same season. Cincinnati gained the nation's attention the week before with a shocking upset of Wisconsin. The first Buckeye drive yielded a field goal sparked by a Steve Belisari 19-yard run. His mobility continued to provide an extra dimension to the Buckeye offensive attack. After Cincinnati answered with a field goal of its own, the Bearcats struck with a big play. Deontay Kenner's pass to Ladarius Van somehow got through Gary Berry's coverage, and 75 yards later, Ohio State trailed 10-3. Kenner had success all day throwing against Ohio State, ending up with 343 yards passing. The vertical offense also opened the UC running game.
Kenner calling for the football. He has it and runs a draw right up the middle. 30, 20, Deontay Kenner. He's all the way into the end zone for a touchdown. A quarterback draw out of the shotgun. A 35-yard run by Deontay Kenner has given the Bearcats a 16-3 lead over Ohio State.
Trailing 17-3, the Buckeyes opted for Austin Mockerman off the bench to relieve Steve Belisari, but nothing materialized. When Belisari came back, he once again sparked the offense.
Wide out east side of the field, Belisari the snap, fakes the handoff, turns for the 34 to throw, fakes, now fires for Rambo, long in the right side, he's got it at the 15, and into the end zone, Kenyon Rambo. Belisari hit him on the fly down the right sideline, a 59-yard scoring strike. The Buckeyes still trail Cincinnati 17-9.
If it isn't broke, don't fix it. The Buckeyes went that route again.
With Wiley and Martin, wide out seat side, Belisari back to throw. Rolling now at the 30. He looks, he fires long. Down the middle of the field, Kenyon Rambo giving chase. He's got it, and is tackled at the 4-yard line. Kenyon Rambo, Tinker Keck, and Jeff Burrow finally caught up with him. But Belisari zeroes in on Kenyon Rambo. It'll be first and goal Buckeyes at the Bearcat 3.
And for the second straight week, Ohio State scored a touchdown to tie up the game late in the second half. Michael Wiley had the honors from 3 yards out. The defense came out in the second half determined to make something happen. Rodney Bailey tipped a pass that Jason Ott intercepted. And combing the offense for a big play, Derek Combs took the handoff on a draw play, 39 yards, setting up the Buckeyes first and goal at the Cincinnati 5. The junior from Grove City scored his first touchdown of the year on the next play, and Ohio State finally had the lead, 24-17. A couple of possessions later, the Buckeyes hit for another big play.
Belisari heads up the I formation, pitch Wiley, left side. Wiley's turning to throw, heaves it downfield for Rambo, and Rambo with it at the 20. To the 10 goes Rambo, and taken out of bounds at the 5-yard line, Kenyon Rambo. Michael Wiley with his first pass of the year, Bobby Fuller, the cornerback, makes the touchdown saving tackle, a 50-yard Michael Wiley completion to Kenyon Rambo.
For Rambo, it was his third catch of the day. All were for more than 50 yards, a new school record. That one set up a Steve Belisari touchdown run from 11 yards out, the first quarterback to run for a score since Stan Jackson in 1997, ending a 28-game drought. With a young team, any win is a good win. John Cooper has had plenty of more impressive wins at Ohio State, but only this one could be called his 100th career coaching win for the Buckeyes.
At the start of the 1999 season, only 5 active Division I head football coaches could boast more career wins than Ohio State's John Cooper. While he would finish the year with 184 over his 23-year career, it would be the win over Cincinnati that would provide a major milestone in Columbus.
It started on September 10, 1988. Ohio State defeated Syracuse 26-9 for John Cooper's first Buckeye win in his first game as head coach. 11 years and 15 days later, OSU beat Cincinnati 34-20, marking the 100th time the coach walked off the field after an Ohio State win.
To win 100 football games at a great school like Ohio State and be the second coach in the history of the school to accomplish that is certainly a great honor.
The only other man to win more than 100 games at Ohio State was the legendary Woody Hayes. It took him 145 games to reach that landmark, while Cooper needed just 138.
To reach 100 victories faster than any coach in the history, including the great Woody Hayes. And Woody Hayes set the standards that we all try to live by and, you know, try to meet.
Not even Hayes was exempt from the tremendous expectations placed on Buckeye football coaches. Even though his trip was rocky at times, Cooper thought this was an attainable milestone.
All the great tradition that we've had here, the great players that we've had here, I thought if I stayed here long enough, obviously I better win that many football games.
Coach Cooper isn't one to rest on his laurels, though. His OSU win count stands at 103, but it's a total that he plans on adding to.
I'm going to end my coaching career at Ohio State. I just signed a new 5-year contract, and there's no better place in college football to coach, and I don't think there's any better place in Ohio to live, in Columbus, Ohio.
The Buckeyes headed into Big Ten play with a respectable 3-1 record, but still not satisfied with the way they played so far in 99. A chance to fix that came in the conference opener against Wisconsin. The defense started out strong when Nate Clemens hit the Badgers' Chris Chambers and knocked the ball loose. Niall Diggs made the recovery. But the Buckeyes couldn't capitalize. Michael Wiley was separated from the ball, diving over the goal line, and Wisconsin recovered. Offensive coordinator Mike Jacobs and his unit didn't panic, however. The next possession resulted in an 8-play, 72-yard drive. Wiley got redemption, carrying it in the final yard for a 7-0 Ohio State lead. After the defense kept the Badger offense confused, the Buckeye offense found its main weapon yet again.
Motions to the right side, joining Germany as a receiver. Pitch Bells, reverse handoff, Rambo coming to the left side at his own 45, to the Badger 45, to the 40, down the sideline and taken out of bounds at the 25 is Kenyon Rambo on the reverse.
That set up a Dan Stoltz 35-yard field goal, and it was 10-0 Ohio State. The quick start OSU had hoped for got an added bonus on the next possession.
Martin and Wiley power eye. Play fake Belisari, sets at the 50. Heaves it down the middle of the field for Reggie Germany. He's bumped but makes the grab. Comes down in the end zone with a ball. Touchdown Reggie Germany as he is harassed all the way into the end zone while making the catch.
One of the greatest catches you'll see. Reggie Germany comes up with the score and a 17-0 lead. As the half ended, however, there was a sense that Wisconsin was starting to get things going. Two Vitaly Pasetsky field goals made the halftime score 17-6 in favor of the Buckeyes. But the very first play of the second half provided a drastic momentum swing.
Michael Wiley, Nate Clemens back to await the kickoff for Ohio State. Ball in the air. Wiley, a couple yards deep in the end zone, fields it, brings it out. Right side, 10, 15. Spun away, football fumbled, and it looks like the Badgers have it.
Wisconsin didn't waste time capitalizing as Ron Dayne scored the first Badger touchdown from 3 yards out. The two-point try failed, but the lead was cut to 5. After an Ohio State punt, Wisconsin took the lead. Ron Dayne finished the last 11 yards of a drive, and the Badgers rallied for an 18-17 advantage. The physical Wisconsin running game then opened up the passing lanes. Brooks Bollinger found Chad Coons for a 29-yard pickup. That set up the third Ron Dayne score of the day, and Ohio State was in trouble, trailing 28-17. Soon after, the roof caved in.
Ohio State showing possibly a blitz, hand to Dayne, up the middle, 45, 40. Down the middle he goes in a foot race, Dayne to the 20, to the 15, he stumbles and lands at the 3 as Percy King tripped him up. If it had not been for Percy King, Dayne may have been in the house for the fourth time today.
Somehow the Badgers came back from a 17-0 deficit to rally for a 42-17 win. The worst home loss for Ohio State since 1967 left John Cooper scratching his head.
That was a good old-fashioned butt-kicking, I guess you'd say. I guess that's the best way I can put it. That I'm embarrassed the way we played in the second half. And again, this week, I guess you give the other team credit. Anytime they have the ball 10 minutes longer than you do, anytime they run 87 plays and you only run 58 and you can't stop them in the second half, and you fumble the football, you're going in for one score and you fumble the second half kickoff and give them the momentum and, you know, got outplayed the entire second half of the ball game. I'm, you know, my hat's off to Wisconsin's football team, but I'm not a very happy camper the way we played today.
From one Heisman candidate to another, Purdue visited the Horseshoe the following week. Quarterback Drew Brees and the pass-happy Boilermakers presented a different challenge to the OSU defense. The Buckeye special teams made Brees wait a bit, though, by forcing a fumble on the opening kickoff. Percy King knocked the ball loose while Gary Berry pounced on it. Derek Combs made it 7-0 when he found the end zone from 5 yards out, and for the second straight week, the Buckeyes were off to a quick start. Purdue evened things up, though. Wide receiver Vinny Sutherland threw the ball back to Drew Brees, who kept his balance for the 12-yard touchdown, and the game was tied at 7. It was the Boilermaker running game that gave Purdue a lead, however. Freshman Montrell Lowe broke tackles, helping set up a Purdue field goal and a 10-7 lead. Travis Dorsch added another field goal just before the half, and Purdue took a 13-7 lead into the locker room. In the second half, the Buckeyes went back to a proven formula for success.
Ohio State first and 10 at their own 49-yard line, trailing 13-7, 9:19 left of the third quarter. Pelissieri, play fix, looks to throw, needs it down the right side for Rambo. He's got it at the 15 to the 10, and he's tackled just inside the 10-yard line. Kenyon Rambo by safety Ralph Turner, but the Buckeyes go through the air to set up first and goal.
After that, offensive coordinator Mike Jacobs went to one of his favorite plays.
Pelissieri marks out the call under center, drops back, hands to Wiley. Wide to the right, throws in the end zone. Touchdown, Darnell Sanders, as Wiley throws his second career touchdown pass. And the Buckeyes are an extra point away from taking the lead. The game is tied at 14.
After Purdue was forced to punt, Ohio State went back to the air. Junior receiver Reggie Germany had begun to show an acrobatic flair for making great leaping catches. This one set up a Dan Stoltz field goal, and Ohio State had a 17-13 lead. The lead had shrunk to 17-16 when Steve Belisari was intercepted by Purdue's Willie Fells. He returned the pick all the way back to the Ohio State 5-yard line. And on the next play, Montrell Lowe gave Purdue the lead once again. And even though the two-point conversion failed, the Boilermakers led 22-17. With 10:26 left in the fourth quarter, the Buckeyes went on a 13-play, 76-yard drive that swallowed up 5 minutes of playing time. Twice, Ohio State fumbled, but determined not to give up the football, each time a Buckeye recovered, keeping the drive alive. Jonathan Wells finally passed the goal line, and Ohio State took a 25-22 lead with just over 5 minutes remaining. But Purdue didn't quit, moving the ball downfield deep into Buckeye territory inside the Ohio State 20, fourth and three from the Buckeye 12-yard line.
59 seconds left, and Purdue trying to tie the game here in the fourth quarter. Everybody's set. Danny Rogers spots it. Travis Dorst, kick is blocked. The ball is loose and it's on the field. The field goal try is blocked, and Ohio State comes up with a special teams play that they have been in need of all season long.
The special teams came through with its first big play of the season. Brent Johnson preserved a hard-fought 25-22 Buckeye win. Steve Belisari's 68-yard run capped Ohio State's best effort to date. The Bucks moved to 4-2 on the year, evening up the Big Ten record at 1-1. The Purdue win gave the Buckeyes much-needed confidence heading into the next game, a trip to Happy Valley to play second-ranked Penn State. Since the Nittany Lions joined the conference in 1993, both teams have been ranked with at least one team undefeated before each meeting. Penn State's offense had shown big play potential during the 1999 season, and that continued when Eric McCoo broke through the line for a 53-yard run right up the middle. Defensive end James Cotton finally ran down the speedy Lion tailback to prevent a touchdown. But two plays later, Penn State did find the end zone on a 6-yard pass from Mike Thompson, and quickly the Buckeyes were in a 7-0 hole. Then the one thing that Ohio State could not afford to have happen, happened. Steve Belisari was sacked by Courtney Brown, fumbling the ball back to the Lions. But the defense did not allow a first down, and the Buckeyes then blocked their second straight field goal attempt dating back to the win over Purdue. That sparked the offense. On 3rd and 16, Belisari took off, scrambling for a huge gain of 44 yards. Shortly after, Dan Stoltz kicked a 47-yard field goal, and it was 7-3 Penn State. For the rest of the first half, the Buckeye defense kept the Lions out of the end zone. Penn State did add another pair of field goals for a 13-3 lead. Then the defense went on the offensive.
Cool. Cirabelli shifting laterally, back is Thompson into the end zone. He's hit while throwing, football fumble.
Touchdown!
The Buckeyes will have it in the end zone. It's Gary Berry with his third career defensive score as the ball was knocked away from Kevin Thompson. And Thompson may be flat on his back.
He's still down.
Ohio State gets a touchdown.
Ohio State took Penn State's best shot and, despite struggling on offense, trailed only 13-10 at the half. With Kevin Thompson injured on the Buckeye touchdown, Rashard Casey played the rest of the game under center. His scrambling ability troubled Ohio State and hiked the lead up to 20-10. Mr. McCoo did more damage. He broke off another long run, all part of a 22-carry, 211-yard afternoon. It was the second straight game in Beaver Stadium that Ohio State allowed a 200-yard rusher. Even though the Buckeyes lost a 23-10 decision and still had some open field tackling problems, the defense overall played pretty well. Tying up ball carriers behind the line was not a problem. In fact, Ohio State set a new school record with 19 tackles for losses. The offense, meanwhile, had only 143 total yards. It was the lowest yardage output of any Ohio State team in a single game in 28 years. The 1999 season had reached a crossroads.
Playing at a school like Ohio State brings many traditions. Near the top of that list has to be taking the field at Ohio Stadium, running out through the tunnel in front of 95,000 fans. Now, since most of us will never experience that by playing for the Buckeyes, here's a chance for you to view exactly what that is like through the eyes of a player.
Because you practiced good this week. Get after their ass and out-hit them. If you out-hit them and out-hustle them and you have fun doing that, you'll kick the crap out of this football team. If you go out there and let them live like you did last week and let them think they got a chance, then you got a battle on your hands. They know that we're disappointed in the way we played in the first three ball games. I got this is Ohio State, okay? Go out there and play. You put that jersey on, you go out there and play hard every play. Play for and make the breaks, and when comes your way, score. The defense is going to get the football for you today, offense. You get the ball, go score. Just get that score. No,
did not get any easier with a trip to Minnesota. The Golden Gophers were much improved and under head coach Glenn Mason ranked 24th in the country. Ohio State's defense got things started on the right foot when Nate Clements intercepted a Billy Cockrum pass on the third play of the game and returned it to the Minnesota 5-yard line. Two plays later, Michael Wiley scored from 4 yards out, and just like they needed to do on the road, Ohio State jumped out to a quick 7-0 lead. As the second quarter began, Minnesota evened the score. On a play the Buckeye defense struggled with all year long, Cockrum called his own number on the option and scored from 9 yards out to tie the game at 7. When Minnesota got the ball back, Cockrum took to the air, finding Luke Leverson for a 38-yard pickup. That set up a Gopher field goal and a 10-7 halftime lead. The Buckeye offense got a boost in the second half from backup quarterback Austin Mockerman. His presence forced the Gopher defense to respect the passing game. And in turn, that opened up the running game.
Second and 6, Buckeyes from the Minnesota 44. Hand Wiley up the middle, 40. Wiley, 35. To the 20 goes Michael Wiley. 10-5 and touchdown, Michael Wiley. He tears one off for his second score of the day to give Ohio State on a 44-yard run their second lead of the game.
And the Buckeyes jumped out to a 14-10 lead. After the Buckeye defense forced a 3-play-and-out series, Minnesota grabbed the momentum back. Mockerman turned the ball over at the Gopher 48. With a shortened field, Minnesota took advantage. Thomas Hamner's 7-yard touchdown run got the lead back, all part of a 100-yard day for the Ohio native. When Steve Belisari returned, he too provided a spark, but in his own way.
So the lefty, Steve Belisari, under center and back into quarterback, takes the snap, pitch Wiley going to the right. Wiley turning, he's going to throw it back to Belisari. He has it left side at the 35. Down to the 25, Belisari, dragged out of bounds by Delvin Jones. Michael Wiley completes another pass, but this time to the quarterback.
That allowed Dan Stoltz to tie the game at 17 with a 43-yard field goal. After Cockrum came up short on third down, the Buckeyes got the ball back with under 5 minutes to play. The OSU offense dug deep and won the battle in the trenches. Michael Wiley ripped off 13 yards, part of his 118-yard game, the ninth 100-yard day of his career. That was followed by 9 yards from Jonathan Wells. Finally, stalled at the 22-yard line, Dan Stoltz was summoned from the sidelines.
Hauser over the ball to snap it. Steve Belisari will spot it at the 30. Everybody set. Stoltz approaches. He kicks. Ball in the air toward the uprights, and he's got it. Dan Stoltz. He's put Ohio State ahead with a field goal of 40 yards.
When the Buckeyes forced a fumble on the ensuing kickoff, a hard-fought victory came Ohio State's way. It wasn't easy, but the Buckeyes earned their 16th straight win over the Gophers dating back to 1981. Ohio State also remained undefeated in the Metrodome. An absolutely gorgeous day for college football is what October 30th, 1999 will be remembered for. It also would be the Buckeyes' most dominating performance of the season. Making things even more perfect was homecoming weekend, although Iowa tried its best to crash the party. The Hawkeyes marched 57 yards in 6 plays on the game's opening drive. It was capped by an 18-yard touchdown pass from Scott Mullen to Kevin Casper, and with a 2-point conversion, Iowa had an 8-0 lead. The points were the Hawkeyes' first all season in the first quarter and only the second passing touchdown of the year. The Buckeyes had an answer, however. Michael Wiley had runs of 12 and 9 yards on Ohio State's first 2 plays. Then Steve Belisari hooked up with Kenyon Rambo for a 17-yard gain to keep the chains moving. Iowa defense stiffened, but on 4th and goal from the 1, Jonathan Wells got into the end zone, and Ohio State cut the lead to 8-7. On the second play of the second quarter, Ohio State took the lead.
Keller and Wiley moving around in the formation, and Wiley will go to a slot on the right for quarterback Steve Belisari. Bucks out the call, Belisari back to throw, pressure coming. Belisari runs it up the middle, steps out of one tackle, moves to the 10, to the 5, and Belisari into the end zone, rushes for his second touchdown of the year on the ground, and Steve Belisari with a scoring run of 18 yards has given Ohio State the lead as safety Michael Brown could not stop it.
On the Buckeyes' next possession, Belisari's arm did the work. First, he found Rambo with a deep pass, a play that gained 58 yards. Then, from 3 yards out, Belisari hit Kevin Hauser for the senior tight end's first career touchdown. 3 Buckeye possessions, 3 touchdowns, and a 21-8 lead. The Buckeyes also started the second half with a score. Jonathan Wells crossed the goal line for the second time on the day, and OSU led by 20. But Iowa wasn't finished. After a field goal, the Hawkeyes tried and were successful with an onside kick. But 3 plays later, senior Ahmed Plummer put an end to any comeback hopes with his 4th interception of the year. When Iowa got the ball again, a couple of Ohio State's younger players stepped up on defense.
Buckeyes showed a blitz on defense. Mullen back to throw. Rolling down the left side. He's at the 40. Turns. Hit while throwing. Intercepted. Ohio State's Kenny Peterson with the ball. Down the right sideline. He's going to run down to the 35. Up the middle to the 25. Bumps into one of his men and he fumbles the ball. Brent Johnson falls it on the 3. And that's where the play will be blown to an end, maybe.
Joe Cooper forced the bad pass. And the Buckeyes had good field position. On 3rd and 12, Belisari began to scramble when Kenyon Rambo came into his sights.
3rd and 12, Ohio State from Iowa's 40. Belisari out of the shotgun. Buckeyes back with it at Belisari from the 49. Lots of time rolling to the right. Now guns it upfield. Rambo wide open. 15, 10, 5, and touchdown. Kenyon Rambo as Steve Belisari caught him with a fling pass. And the Buckeyes throw 6 more on the board.
It was all part of another great day for the junior wideout. 7 catches for 179 yards. His third 150-yard plus game on the season was already third most in school history. The scoring was completed when Austin Mockerman tossed it to Van S. Provitt. The junior wide receiver made an incredible grab for his first career touchdown. 41-11 was the final, with Ohio State racking up 534 yards of total offense. The Buckeyes appear to be reaching their potential with a tough trip to Michigan State looming.
On a day when three of Ohio State's greatest teams were honored, its greatest player received a very special surprise at halftime of the Iowa game. Two-time Heisman Trophy winner Archie Griffin became the very first Buckeye player ever to have his jersey retired.
There's never been any question that number 45 has been number one in the hearts of Buckeye fans. Archie Griffin embodied the spirit of Ohio State football on his way to the Heisman Trophy in both 1974 and 75. He was also part of four Big Ten champions and is still the only player in history to start four Rose Bowl games. Among his remaining NCAA records, 31 straight 100-yard rushing games and 33 in his career, it's fitting that his jersey was the first to be formally retired.
When you think about Ohio State University and the fact that over the years that we did not retire jerseys, to be the first is quite an honor.
Griffin never had the opportunity to decline. He had no idea that the university had all of this planned during the halftime ceremony.
It's kind of hard to keep a secret in our athletic department, but they did a wonderful job that day. Or maybe I was just a little naive and just wasn't going to put anything together. But I commend them on how they did it.
Athletic director Andy Geiger presented Griffin with his framed jersey, setting off a flood of emotions.
When Andy came out with the framed jersey, it hit me right then. I said, I don't believe it. They're going to retire the jersey. They're really going to retire the jersey. And that's when I was overwhelmed. It really got me, caught me by surprise. And I guess the proper term is that I lost it.
Over the next few years, Ohio State plans to retire all the jerseys of Heisman Trophy winners. Les Horvath's number 22, Vic Janowitz's number 31, Howard Cassidy's 40, and Eddie George's 27 will be memorialized forever.
This is the first, so you know, I'm overwhelmed by it. You know, it's a great honor to have your jersey retired. No one can wear the number again and all that. But you know, what can I say? I mean, I'm thrilled.
I think that says a lot for the athletic department and the university as a whole, because those jerseys will be displayed in a renovated stadium that I think everybody will be extremely proud of.
As the Buckeyes traveled to East Lansing, Michigan in Week 10, revenge was certainly on their minds. After all, it was Michigan State who ruined Ohio State's season the year before with a stunning 28-24 win in Columbus over the then number one ranked Bucks.
The Spartans had a week off to get ready for the Buckeyes, and to make matters worse, MSU had lost its two previous games. The Buckeyes took the opening kick and moved the ball all the way down to the Spartan 26, but two sacks pushed OSU out of field goal range. Michigan State couldn't get much going either. James Cotton came clean and sacked Bill Burke. Finally, 20 minutes into the game, the first points went on the board. Unfortunately, they came from the foot of Paul Ettinger. That got the Spartan offense going. On its next possession, Ahmed Plummer slipped, and Burke found Plaxico Burris for a 17-yard touchdown pass, and MSU opened a 10-0 lead. After an Ohio State punt, Michigan State moved down the field again, getting inside the Buckeye one-yard line. On fourth and goal, Michigan State took control of the game.
So fourth and goal at the one. Burke under center. His back's in a line. Tight end off the line to the left. Now Baker will shift to the right. Handoff. It's a fake handoff to Duckett. Burke rolling left side. Guns in the end zone, and it's caught for a touchdown by tight end Chris Baker.
So the Spartans took a 17-0 lead into the locker room. But Ohio State got back into it in the third quarter.
DeJuan Moss, T.J. Duckett in the offset eye. Tight end Baker sets in a slot to the right. Back is Bill Burke, the quarterback, to throw. Right side ball knocked away and intercepted. Coming up the left side, Ahmed Plummer, the cornerback. He brings it up to the 25, to the 20, and finally at the 15-yard line is where the play comes to an end, and a penalty flag is dropped at the end of a 35-yard interception return by senior Ahmed Plummer.
As they had done all year, the Buckeye defense set up the OSU offense. This Steve Belisari pass to Michael Wiley pulled Ohio State to within 17-7. But that was as close as the Buckeyes would get. Michigan State's defense was dominating, limiting Ohio State to 79 yards of offense, all of which was passing. It was the worst rushing performance by a Buckeye team since the Michigan game in 1965 and the fewest yards of total offense since a game with Penn State in 1963. On the bright side, one of the Buckeyes' young stars on defense began to shine. Freshman Michael Doss registered a career-high 12 tackles. As hard as it had been to explain the 1999 season, what happened the next week went beyond comprehension. The winner of the Ohio State-Illinois game would clinch a winning record on the year and become eligible for a bowl game. The Buckeyes looked sharp early, moving down the field thanks to the running efforts of Michael Wiley. But the tone for the day was set on a 3rd-and-5. Jonathan Wells fumbled a pitch and Illinois recovered 18 yards behind the line of scrimmage, setting up an Illini field goal. Deciding to leave it all on the field, Illinois faked a punt on its next possession, setting up another three-pointer from Illini kicker Neil Rackers. The breaks kept going Illinois' way in the second quarter. Ahmed Plummer got a hand on this Kurt Kittner pass, but Brandon Lloyd wound up with the ball and a 12-0 Illinois lead. On their next possession, the Illini stayed on the throttle. Steve Avard ran it in from 7 yards out, and Ohio Stadium sat stunned as the Buckeyes fell behind 19-0. Ohio State then mounted a rally. Steve Belisari completed passes to Reggie Germany and Kenyon Rambo, moving to the Illini 35-yard line.
Buckeyes from the Illinois 35, give to Wiley, right side, 35-30. Wiley to the 20, he's to the 10, right sideline, and into the end zone goes Michael Wiley as he took the handoff and raced it down the right side for his 9th touchdown of the season. Linebacker Danny Clark couldn't catch up with him. Buckeyes on the board, trailing 19-6.
The Buckeye defense tried to keep momentum by stuffing Illinois on 4th-and-goal. But after Illinois kicked another field goal later in the quarter, disaster struck. Kenyon Rambo fumbled the ensuing kickoff, giving Illinois the ball 1st-and-goal at the 1-yard line. On 3rd down, Kittner tossed his 2nd touchdown of the day, finding tight end Josh Whitman for a score and an inexplicable 29-7 Illinois halftime lead. Ohio State didn't have an answer after the break either. Using a play that the Buckeyes couldn't stop throughout the game, Kittner tossed a screen to Jameel Cook that went 25 yards for another touchdown and a 36-7 lead. Ohio State scored 2 other touchdowns in the game. Steve Belisari found a wide-open Matt Keller for a 38-yard score. And sophomore tailback Jonathan Wells set up the other by bursting up the middle 52 yards on a draw play. For the game, Wells had 63 yards on 5 carries. Michael Wiley scored again to cap the drive from 6 yards out to finish out the scoring 43-20. This was an afternoon that baffled the Buckeyes. Ohio State surrendered the most points at home in 53 years.
The last week of the season always means just one thing, Michigan. It usually also means, however, a Big Ten championship is on the line as well as a Rose Bowl berth. But for the first time since 1994, the conference championship had already been decided before the game was even played.
Traveling to Ann Arbor, the Buckeyes had only one thing left to play for, and that was pride. That team up north had been established as a 12.5-point favorite and was coming off its most impressive win of the season, a come-from-behind victory over Penn State. Ohio State responded with its best overall game of the season. In the first quarter, the Buckeye offense took charge. Faced with a 3rd-and-6, Michael Wiley caught the Wolverine defense off guard, going around the end for a big 26-yard pickup. 2 plays later, OSU scored.
2nd-and-goal from the 6-yard line. Keller and Wiley again in the eye. Fake pitch, Belisari throwing left corner of the end zone. No, it's at the 2. Yeah. Hauser with it, he goes to the end zone for a score. Kevin Hauser with a catch. It would be his 2nd touchdown. And Ohio State on the board on a 6-yard pass play.
For the 6th straight year, the Buckeyes were on the board first against their rivals. After the teams exchanged possessions, Michigan responded. A screen pass to Anthony Thomas picked up 32 yards, getting the Wolverines inside the OSU 15-yard line. Michigan called Thomas's number again on 2nd-and-goal from the 1, and he answered, tying the score at 7 apiece. Ohio State didn't back down. The Buckeye offense paid Michigan back in full with the fullback.
Jamar Martin in at fullback. He and Michael Wiley make up the eye. Two receivers wide to the left. And the left-hander Bellisari hands to Martin, the fullback. Left side to the 30, 35, still to the 40 goes Jamar Martin. He lugged a couple of Wolverines along for the ride. But finally, Jamar Martin tears one off, giving the Buckeyes a first down at their own 40.
On a key third and 13 play, Steve Bellisari found Van S. Provid for a 19-yard gain. That set up Martin again, who burst up the middle of the Michigan defense for 14 more yards. For all his work on this drive, the sophomore fullback was rewarded.
Martin and Wiley in the eye. Bellisari under center with the ball. Back to throw is Bellisari. Guns and Jamar Martin's got it in the end zone on the right side, making the touchdown catch. And the big rumble, Jamar Martin, who was the big contributor on that drive, gets the touchdown catch, his first catch of the year for a score. And the Buckeyes take a 13-7 lead.
And that would be the halftime score, as Ohio State was in control throughout the game's first 30 minutes. The second half opened with more of the same problems that plagued this young Buckeye team all year long. Steve Bellisari was intercepted at midfield, and the return came all the way back to the Ohio State 23-yard line. The Buckeye defense stiffened, though, and did not allow a first down. But Hayden Epstein's 43-yard field goal brought the score to 14-10. A potentially disastrous play turned into a huge one on the ensuing kickoff. After mishandling the kick, Kenyon Rambo picked up the ball, dodged and hurdled would-be tacklers, and returned it all the way to the Michigan 43-yard line. On that same drive, the Buckeyes rolled the dice on 4th-and-2.
Kenyon Rambo wide right, Keller and Wiley in the eye. Bellisari under center, pitch Wiley going right side. Wiley's going to back up, throw, he puts it in the air for Rambo. Got it at the 19 and out of bounds at the 15. Kenyon Rambo and Michael Wiley continues his perfect passing streak. Cornerback Todd Howard with a stop of Rambo, but Wiley does it again with his arm.
From there, the 7-point lead was restored when Dan Stoltz connected on a 27-yard kick. Ohio State led 17-10 with over 8 minutes to play in the third quarter. The next few minutes would see the momentum swing. The Buckeyes had a chance to take a commanding lead. Rising star Michael Doss forced a Tom Brady fumble that Clinton Wayne recovered at the Michigan 18-yard line. Then Jonathan Wells ripped off his best run of the season.
High formation behind Steve Bellisari. Barks out the call. Rambo motioning to the left, joining Germany as the second receiver. And a handoff, and it's to the tailback, Combs. Right side, 20. 25 to Wells, beg your pardon, and he's at the 35. Spinning by to the 30. Wells to the 50, and he's in Michigan territory. Wells to the 20. He's to the 10, and tackled just shy of the 5.
On third and goal, though, Michigan's defense came up big with a sack, and only Kevin Hauser's recovery prevented a turnover. That came with a cost, however. Hauser, the snapper, and Bellisari, the holder, both seemed shaken up on the play, and a field goal attempt was missed. More importantly, a huge opportunity was lost. As usually happens in a rivalry like this, Michigan didn't fail to capitalize. Steve Bellisari's second interception of the day was returned to the OSU 8. The very next play, Michigan pulled even when Tom Brady tossed to tight end Sean Thompson, who stretched out for the score. After trading fourth quarter punts, the Buckeyes went on the move again. Steve Bellisari scrambled and fought his way for a first down. The OSU offensive line continued to control the line of scrimmage as Michael Wiley cut up the middle for 14 yards. But another OSU turnover proved fatal. Bellisari completed this pass to Provid, but James Whitley jarred the ball loose and Cato June recovered. Then Michigan got things going. A big third and three play resulted in Brady finding Thompson for a 20-yard pickup. Another third down play gained 13 yards for Anthony Thomas, and the Wolverines were on the move. Michigan's offensive line then dominated down the stretch, providing Brady with 9 seconds of protection on this play, allowing him to spot Marquise Walker for a 17-yard pickup. That combination worked again for a 10-yard score and a 24-17 Michigan lead with just over 5 minutes remaining. And the season came to an end when the Buckeyes could not convert on fourth down.
Really proud of the effort that our football team gave forth today. I'm not very happy that we lost the game, because I think we lost a football game today. The team that makes the fewest mistakes usually wins a game, and when you turn it over as many times as we did and have as many penalties as we did, I think somebody said we had 12 penalties and they had one in the ball game. and we didn't do a very good job of throwing the football. I thought we ran the ball today, obviously the best we've had all year long. But I'm really proud of the effort that we gave. Unfortunately, we didn't give that kind of effort all season long. And you know, we're going to miss those senior football players, and hopefully none of us at Ohio State will have to go through another year like this.
For the first time since 1977, Ohio State outgained Michigan by over 100 yards of total offense, but came up short in the win column. Although the year ended with a 6-6 record and no bowl trip for the first time since 1988, the Buckeyes played with heart and desire against Michigan, leaving hope for the year 2000.
Following a decade of 9-3 or worse seasons, Ohio State found itself back among college football's elite during the 1990s. The record books will show 91 wins, 29 losses, and 3 ties during those 10 years. But Ohio State's success went well beyond that.
About the only thing Ohio State did not accomplish in the 90s was winning a national championship. It wasn't for lack of trying, though. Following the 1996 and 98 seasons, the Buckeyes finished second in both major polls. Only 7 other schools can claim more wins than Ohio State's 91 this decade. In addition to playing in the Rose Bowl for the first time since 1984, Ohio State played in 5 straight New Year's Day bowls, including back-to-back Sugar Bowls. Other holidays were celebrated at the Citrus, Hall of Fame, and Holiday Bowls. No less than 19 players earned first-team All-American honors. Linebacker Steve Tovar, tackles Corey Stringer and Orlando Pace, guard Rob Murphy, and cornerback Antoine Winfield were all named twice each. Nyel Diggs rounds out the list, making 1990 the only year without one. Ohio State players make up a who's who list of college football's major award winners. In 1995, Eddie George won the Heisman Trophy, the Doak Walker Trophy, and Maxwell Awards. The same season saw Terry Glenn win the Biletnikoff Award as the nation's top wide receiver. Orlando Pace won the Outland Trophy in both 1995 and 1996, as well as the Lombardi Trophy in 96. Andy Katzenmoyer won the Butkus Award as the top linebacker in 1997, and in 1998, Antoine Winfield garnered the Thorpe Award as the best defensive back. The NFL has also noticed all that talent. 15 Buckeyes have been drafted in the first round, the most of any school. Vinnie Clark was the first back in 1991, followed by the likes of Robert Smith, Joey Galloway, and Ricky Dudley, to name a few. In 1994, Dan Wilkinson was the first pick in the draft, an honor repeated by Orlando Pace 3 years later. Ohio State is not just a football school. Over 100 Buckeyes were named Academic All-Big Ten, including 5 Academic All-Americans. 7 won National Football Foundation scholarships, and quarterback Bobby Hoying won the Vincent DePaul Draddy Award, the academic equivalent to the Heisman Trophy.
Obviously, Ohio State has been a power in college football for most of the century. Now, as the 1900s come to a close, we thought it'd be fun to take a look back at some of the greatest wins in Ohio State football history as voted on by the fans.
Like so many of the great Buckeye games over the years, the 1984 Illinois game featured a monumental comeback. Jack Trudeau threw for the first 3 Illini touchdowns, but Ohio State roared back to score the next 4. The most memorable, a 67-yard Keith Byers jaunt, minus a shoe, but with a victory, a 45-38 win that Earl Bruce gave the highest praise.
It's the greatest win I've ever been associated with, comeback win. I want to tell you something, that was a great job out there today by the players and the coaches.
The 4th-ranked game of all time capped a charmed season for the 1968 undefeated Buckeyes. Facing O.J. Simpson's USC Trojans in the 69 Rose Bowl, Ohio State had to come from behind once again. Trailing 10-0, the comeback started with a Jim Otis 1-yard plunge, then continued with a Rex Kern touchdown pass to Ray Gillian. 27-16 was the final score, but O.J. Simpson had the final say, paying a post-game visit to the Ohio State locker room.
And here came O.J. in with tears streaming down his face, and he said, "You're the best damn football team I ever played against."
That team would never have gotten to that point if not for the 3rd-ranked game in Buckeye football annals. Top-ranked Purdue from that same season drew as much anticipation as any on the schedule that year. Following a scoreless first half, the defense responded with a Ted Provost interception, returned for a touchdown, and the Buckeyes won it 13-0.
It was a defining point. We had a lot of sophomores starting and juniors, and we had the key offensive guys. I think we had that was the game we proved to everybody that we were for real and one of the contenders for the national title.
Notre Dame and Ohio State settled a six-decade grudge in 1995. The Buckeyes scored on big play after big play and outlasted the Irish 45-26. Eddie George carried 32 times for 207 yards and two touchdowns on his way to winning the Heisman Trophy. The 1997 Rose Bowl was a New Year's Day game against undefeated Arizona State that featured five lead changes. Stanley Jackson hit David Boston for a 9-yard touchdown pass, which Jake Plummer answered with a 25-yard strike to Ricky Boyer and a 7-7 halftime tie. After the Sun Devils took a 10-7 lead in the third quarter, Ohio State backup quarterback Joe Germain hooked up with Demetrius Stanley for a 72-yard score, which still stands as the longest touchdown pass in OSU Bowl history. Hollywood doesn't script endings any better than the one that unfolded in Southern California that day. On 3rd and 11, Plummer snaked his way into the end zone to give ASU a 17-14 lead with under 2 minutes to play. The Buckeyes then called on Germain with time running out to go the final distance for the win or suffer a fifth straight Rose Bowl loss.
Joe Germain then drove his team 65 yards, one of the great drives in all of Ohio State football history. 12 plays, 65 yards, culminating with a 5-yard touchdown pass to a freshman, David Boston, with just 19 seconds to go.
Ohio State trailing 17-14. The Buckeyes with a football at the ASU 5-yard line, and Germain back to throw. He looks and he throws on the right side where Boston has it in the one, and he's in the end zone. And the Buckeyes with a touchdown pass have now taken a 20-17 lead over Arizona State.
Holding the Rose Bowl trophy, Joe Germain was never happier that he turned down a scholarship offer to Arizona State. And his teammates obviously remember the 97 Rose Bowl win as their finest moment as Buckeyes.
It had to be that. Had to be that
Rose Bowl. It had to be. I mean,
Joe comes in, last drive of the game, get the job done, throw it to Dave. I feel special right now being beside you guys.
I'll pay you later.
No, I'm serious.
If there's any way I could write a script to, write a script for the ending of a career or ending of for a great senior class, that would be it, and I don't think I could have written a better one.
Ohio State's 1997 Rose Bowl win stands as the best all-time Buckeye football victory.
Unfortunately, none of the wins from the 1999 season will be looked back on with great fondness, but the experiences gained from going through such a difficult season could help springboard the Buckeyes into the next century. We want to thank you for joining us on our look back at the 1999 season. The Buckeyes are certainly looking forward to 2000. And we leave you now with the pride of the Buckeyes, the OSU Marching Band.